Heavenly Father, we come before you asking for the power of the Holy Spirit to do a work that's not human, in human flesh. For a sinner to come before sinners and declare divine things that through the foolishness of preaching, men may be convicted of the soon coming of a Savior and the solemnity of the hour that we live in, that through words, men may be brought to the brink of the precipice to look over the coming destruction that comes upon a world unprepared for Jesus Christ. Pray that you would allow the Holy Spirit to bring these things to our mind and show us that God is making up his number. The world is being divided into two camps. We're called upon to make a decision. Choose ye this day who to serve. This is our cry. This is our declaration in connection with Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world, with the message of looking into the heavenly sanctuary. Lord, all these truths, pray that you would bring them to our mind, put them in their right setting, and cause us to make a decision concerning this last day message. We ask, we pray, we believe in Jesus' name. Let everyone say together, amen. Amen. And Father, I pray that you would settle the room. Send special angels to do a work that we nor ushers can do, calming hearts and minds, young and old, that the message may go forth without interruption. Again, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Tonight, we've gathered together to study the Word of God and allow the Spirit of prophecy to give us understanding. We are people that have lost sight to a tremendous degree of the Spirit of prophecy. The Spirit of prophecy is the 66 books of the Bible, and all the revelations ever come from a prophet. In these last days, God has spoken by an end-time prophet, but we have the Word of God. I'm not on? I'm sorry.
Can you hear me? Amen. Can you hear me? Amen.
Amen. Again, let's pray one more time. Father, we thank you for technology and the means by which these words and the experience that we are entering into and going deeper into can be transmitted all over the world, that saints in various locations, various nations can hear these words. We pray that this technology and even the benefit thereof would not be a hindrance to the moving of the Spirit, that we would keep our hearts and minds prepared, and that the Word of God would not be hindered. For we ask all these blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We are on the verge, we're told, of a stupendous crisis. And the pen of inspiration and the prophetic word has told us that these things are because of the signs that we see soon to come. But it's as if these things have never been revealed among us when we look at the attitude of us as people. Or even, we can even say, when we look at your life, when I look at my life, and I examine my daily activities, my daily thoughts, my habits, my goals and aspirations, do I really believe that Jesus is soon to come? Do I really believe? If I looked at my message traffic on my email, do I really believe? If the history on my computer was surveyed, do I really believe? The calls and text messages on my cell phone, do I really believe? My habits, my bank account, my debits, where I go, where I eat, my GPS that tracks me, my phone that tracks me. Do I really believe? We're living in a time where even the world, the nations, can track with great accuracy the sins of the nations. But we live in a time when God, with terrible exactness, is recording the same. And a people that should understand that with technology, every movement can be calculated and measured and weighed and recorded and used against us, we should also know that God has much greater technology that's able to record these things. And we're living in a judgment hour, but it seems as if we are insensible. And I'm not talking about people that we tend to look at as insensible. I'm talking about people that believe present truth. Those that profess to believe present truth. That believe, even though these messages are soul stirring, that they are better than people in the conference. That they're better than someone else. That they're in trouble, and I wish they had the truth that we have. Do you have the truth?
Do you really have the truth? In your inmost soul, your desire to love Jesus unreservedly is seen in certain manifest evidences that the Spirit of Christ talks about and the Bible talks about. For instance, if we went down every row and every chair here and looked at, asked people who believe in Jesus, who believe Jesus is soon to come, and asked people to raise their hand, and then say, keep your hands raised, and everyone that's at least won one soul to Christ with that zeal, keep it up, how many hands would go down? How many have won one soul to Christ this year by personal labor? You may say, well, winning souls is not important. Is it? Is it? When the Pentecostal says a one soul is worth more than a world? When Jesus came, that whosoever? Jesus gave his life for souls? True zeal for God is manifest in how we deal with our brethren. And our love for those around us is manifest in our desire to see them sold, see them saved. I spoke with a young lady just the other night, and this young lady is an anointed, spirit-filled preacher. And we were talking about the work of God and even the desire to preach and some of the inner struggles that the preacher goes through because they have been called, and even though they have insufficiencies and they must grow in Christ, as anyone else does, this gift laid upon them and this anointing laid upon them causes them to say unto themselves, woe be unto me if I don't preach. And sometimes they can feel like they are not ready, or they're not ready and prepared to preach the word of God as they should. And I was talking with her because as we talk with the scriptures open and look at the various different scriptures, quoting and looking at things, we talked about the fact that a preacher, in order to preach the message, must have a burden. And God puts this burden on supernaturally. It's not a burden that one can see generally. In the book Pilgrim's Progress, it's much talk about this burden that Christian had that others couldn't see. And he said as he read his book in the allegory of Paul Bunyan, as he read this book, this burden became heavier and heavier. As he read this book, this supernatural, invisible burden, this burden for souls, this burden to escape the city of destruction, the burden to go on this pilgrimage and to meet and reach the celestial city became greater and greater upon him. And we talked about how you can't preach the gospel sufficiently. Ellen White says that you can't preach the gospel sufficiently unless you have this burden rolled upon you. You read the prayers of Ellen White, many times you find that she often prayed that God would roll a burden upon the people. Roll a burden upon the people. That they make the burden of the work, because their hilarity and joking and laughing and their sense of insensibility to the dying world around them, their lack of desire to do evangelism, the fact they don't want to knock on doors, they just want to do zip code mailings. These things are indicative of the fact that this burden has not been rolled upon them. Yea, I even wonder if the converting power of God had been rolled upon them. I'm talking about present truth believers. So when we look at this idea of where we are as church history, don't believe because you sit, as Judas did, on the searching message of present truth and hear the message in straight lines that because you're here and you're hearing it, that you are going to be saved. Even I must examine myself without being the faith. I'm talking about present truth believers. And as we come to this most important topic tonight, I want to allow the Word of God to challenge all of us, including myself. And we talk about the title and the message, the Battle of Armageddon. The Battle of Armageddon. The Battle of Armageddon is a tremendous topic of the Word of God. And the term the Battle of Armageddon is known all across Christendom. And there's various views of the Battle of Armageddon. We're going to look at the spiritual view, the biblical view. But there's many views, but the view that many people have of the Battle of Armageddon, even among us, is not in the great controversy theme. I said the view that people have of the Battle of Armageddon is not in the great controversy theme. When we look at the Word of God shows us that this battle is raging even now. This battle is a spiritual battle. It's not a battle that we're waiting for in the Middle East or between Russia and Jerusalem or Syria and Iraq and Jerusalem. We're not talking about earthly battles, even though the nation is being angry and the prophetic moving and marching of the nations is a part of this struggle stretched out throughout the centuries. Yet and still, we're not looking for a battle upon earth generally and locally as a fulfillment of this prophecy. It's a prophecy that's waging in your community. It's waging here in Orlando. It's waging in your home, in your church. It's waging in your heart, even as we preach this message tonight. The Battle of Armageddon is a spiritual battle. And we all must be enlisted or come into the Lord's army or take our side by default on Satan's side. There's only two camps. Jesus does not say through his prophet that there's an Adventist and then the world and then... No. There's two camps. Either you're on God's side or you're on the devil's side. Now, many people don't believe that. They believe there's a third category for Adventists, especially those that believe or say they believe in principles. They believe that they're somehow immune from the need of getting victory over every sin and loving their brother. And loving their brother, again, brothers and sisters, I can't emphasize the point enough, loving that brother in the context of trying to do everything you can to save his soul, including going where it is uncomfortable to try and reach the lost. This is an indication for no sooner than the soul is saved or converted. There's a burning desire in you to share the love of Christ, to go where he has gone, to walk in his footsteps. In the book Seven Bible Commentary, the penetration says this. It says, there are only two parties in our world. Those who are loyal to God and those who stand under the banner of the Prince of Darkness. And those, you might be surprised, that are in the church are also counted among this grand number under the Prince of Darkness. Don't believe that Revelation in vain talks about in one of the seven churches, the synagogue of Satan. And it's very clear that the borders of that synagogue is overlapping with the visible church of God. The Pharisees and Sadducees, Ellen White says, and desired was a part of the synagogue of Satan, the leadership of the church. They were doing the work of their father. Two great groups, those that are loyal to God and those who stand under the banner of the Prince of Darkness. Satan will come down with power and signs and lying wonders to deceive those who dwell upon the earth, and if possible, the very elect. The crisis is right upon us. Is this to paralyze the energies of those who have a knowledge of the truth? Is the influence of the powers of deception so far reaching that the influence of the truth will be overpowered? This is a great question when we look at this battle of Armageddon. When we look at this spiritual battle and how it's going to be waged even in our day, even as we conduct it right now, and will go to the end of time as we know it upon this earth. Let's examine the scriptures together in the book of Revelation. Turn with me to the book of Revelation quickly. Revelation. We want to get a general and wide overview of this idea of the battle of Armageddon. And then we're going to bring it down closer and closer and closer and closer until we end up in your heart and in your home. And I ask you to make a decision to stand upon the Lord's side. In the book of Revelation, it says this. Revelation 12. Revelation the 12th chapter. And we're looking in the 12th chapter of Revelation, verse 7. Revelation 12 and verse 7. Father in heaven, I pray for more of your power in this place today. We know that there is only so much of a limit that humanity can do under the aegis and power of the Holy Spirit, but make me a vessel, dear God. And let this not be just idle words and philosophy and good theological pronouncements. May the power and convicting power of the Holy Spirit move upon hearts and minds and bring conviction that calls us to see sin, righteousness, and judgment, and make a decision for Jesus tonight, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. In the 12th chapter of Revelation, and verse 7, we see the beginning act of this battle of Armageddon, a spiritual battle that encompasses heaven and earth. For those who are taking notes, it's a spiritual battle that encompasses what? Heaven and earth. It's a spiritual battle that began with a great war in heaven. Then this war was communicated and transferred to the earth and continues to this day until and after the close of probation. And we'll see that if we look at this large view, and then come back and make it more and more specific as we go through. In the 12th chapter of Revelation, look at the first skirmish and battle of the Battle of Armageddon. Revelation 12 and verse 7. Say amen if you have that. Amen. Look at this first battle or war in heaven. An army against God. Verse 7 says, and there was war where? In heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels, and prevailed not. Neither was their place found any more in heaven. And that great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Brothers and sisters, where is the first great battle or great skirmish and war of the great battle of Armageddon? Heaven. And who are the antagonists and protagonists in this war? It is Christ and Satan. And this is the beginning or understanding thematic look at the great controversy. The original name of the book, Great Controversy, is the great controversy between Christ and his angels and Satan and his angels. Now they call it something like the Great Hope. Now it's called the Great Hope. Not the great controversy between Christ and his angels and Satan and his angels and us as the pawns in the game in the middle, but the Great Hope. Do you see why we need a revival among us? You see how the devil is stealthily, by men that we are supposedly looking at as conservative, stealing a march and lulling the people to sleep, even the world? The Bible says there was war in heaven. And this war began in heaven with devil and his angels and with God and his angels. And this great contest was not evenly matched, because the Bible says this in the book of Revelation again, Revelation and verse 4. This dragon or Satan knows what it says. In Revelation chapter 12, verse 4, it says, and his tail, meaning the dragon's tail, his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven and did what? And it cast them to the earth. In Revelation 1:20, those stars are angels. Those same angels that fell with him to the earth, they were cast to the earth by his tail, the Bible says. Now, we know we're looking at spiritual things in the Bible. Amen? The book of Revelation is a prophetic and spiritual book. What is this tail? We looked at it the other day. In Isaiah 9 and verse 15, Isaiah 9 and 15, write in your notes, Isaiah 9 and verse 15. Isaiah 9 chapter and the 15th verse says, the ancient and honorable, he is the head. And the prophet that teaches lies, he is the tail. So what was caused to bring the third part of the stars or angels of heaven to be swept out and brought to this earth to tempt and annoy us? Deception. Lies. Satan is the false prophet with the capital P. And he is the one that caused a third part in the first great war to be swept out and brought to the earth for a continuing second battle or a greater skirmish upon the earth, a more continued struggle against God. Now, brothers and sisters, the important point is here. If in the beginning, this is what happened, does not the Bible say the first shall be last? And the last shall be just as the... So shall we see a struggle in the last days between Christ and his followers or angels or messengers and Satan and his hosts? And shall we see also that Satan's host will not be a number that is unknown, it'll be a third part as well. It'll be a third part as well. Because the first battle we see in Revelation chapter 12, and then we see a span of some untold thousands of years, because we don't know how long this battle raged in heaven. We don't know how long it took, but we know that there's 6,000 years of Earth's history. But through a whole series of time, we come to the 16th chapter of Revelation, and we see a major battle brewing in the 16th chapter. Look what it says here now. Revelation 16. Revelation 16. We're looking at the great controversy theme, and this idea of the battle of Armageddon. And we're looking at a wide view, beginning in heaven and then going to the earth. In the 16th chapter of Revelation, it says this. Revelation 16. Revelation 16. And let's drop our eyes down in Revelation chapter 16, all the way down to verse 13. Revelation chapter 16 and verse 13. Say amen when you have that. Amen. It says, and I saw three unclean spirits. How many spirits?
Three.
What do you see in heaven? You saw a third part, and now you see threefold union. Three in the beginning, three at the end. Notice what it says. These are unclean spirits like frogs that come out of the mouth of the dragon and the mouth of the beast and the mouth of the false prophet, for they are the spirits of devils working what? The same devils that were cast on the earth in the beginning are seen here at the end of time, and they are trying to deceive the very elect. They're using the same power that caused them to fall upon others. The same abuse that was given to them that caused them to fall, they have no recourse because their natures are so corrupted. They're using the same sophistry that brought them down upon us. Misery loves company. So now the deception that brought them was educating them in unrighteousness. Now they are spirits of devils working the same miracles and deceptions which go forth in the kings of the earth and the whole world to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty. What is that great day of God Almighty, which is the counterpart to that first act in heaven with the devil and his angel? Look what it says here. Verse 16. And he gathered them together into a place called in the Hebrew tongue what? Armageddon. The Valley of Megiddo. This term is not a term that we have not seen before. Everything in the Revelation has been seen before. It's a study for those that are students of the Word of God. And the idea of Megiddo is something that we've seen before, but we've seen. Let's recap. We've seen two scenes in the great battle of Armageddon. The first with Satan, with a third being swept out to the earth to continue a war that he almost fully lost in heaven, but he was given an opportunity for a second battle upon the earth. Even given 6,000 years to control and to try and force and manipulate and logistically get his troops together for a final onslaught. There have been skirmishes and battles all through the way, but we've seen the 16th chapter of Revelation, a development at the end time where God is making us see that this great battle that we see between God and Satan, between his seed and her seed, is continued in the last days and is being mentioned or put in the biblical imagery of something that happened at the Valley of Megiddo in the Old Testament. Now, if we're Bible students, we understand what happened at the Valley of Megiddo. Do we know what happened at the Valley of Megiddo? Okay, no one said amen. One or two people. Let's look at that. Before we do so, though, I want you to again see that when we look at this scene, from heaven all the way down to this last day, and this is also happening to a great degree, its last true application, even though we see these threefold unions coming together and working now, the great application of how this scene will take place in this scene here under the sixth plague. The principles of this battle of Armageddon coming to its height comes to a fevered pitch around the close of probation. And then there is what we'll see in a minute, there is a ceasefire or an armistice, and then it reignites at a later period. We're going to see that very clearly, but I want to show you something very important. There are two groups developed by this message. The message of Satan, the deception of Satan in the beginning, caused a third to fall. The threefold union, or the three frog message, the counterfeit of the three angels message, comes in to try and cause the whole world through the wine of Babylon to fall and to be drunk with her. Are you following me? This is all the imagery to receive from Daniel and Revelation. This wine and this fornication and this end time scenario, this doctrine, this spiritualism comes in connection with the dragon, in connection with the false prophet, to do a work with the Vatican, to do a last day work upon the earth to cause the people of God to stumble. Third fell through deception, and here through the three frog message, another group is going to be deceived, even the whole world, except those that have the three angels message, except those that truly abide in the message of the three angels. And there are two groups developed by the three angels message going into the world when the whole world is deceived by these last day deception of spiritualism, ecumenism, Catholicism, and apostate Protestantism. These major forces in the world are going and gathering together to call the last people upon the earth to hate religion and the religious. If you don't believe that hating religion and the religious is coming to our day, everything that's happening now to Muslims is coming to your doorstep. Everything that's happening to Muslims, because again, it's a religious group, whatever you believe about Islam, it's a religious group, and because of their faith, because of their religious persuasion, there are laws being made to try and trump their religious interests for the sake of safety, and that way of doing it is repealing and removing our rights. And when we look at the Islamic people, regardless of what the Islamic faith may be, and I'm understanding from Revelation, understand that the true Muslim people, their women, wear long skirts and are dressed modestly. The true Islamic women dress modestly. The true Islamics do not eat pork or any unclean food. And many of them eat a very healthy diet. The Islamic people follow a prophet and have a special holy book. The Islamic people have a special day upon which they worship, which is not Sunday. Do you hear what I'm talking about tonight? How easy is it to take the blueprint, the thumbprint, the blueprint for torture and even for a restriction of religious liberties that is being propagated upon the Islamics and throw Seventh-day Adventists inside there by and by? The Pentecostal says that there are situations coming together in the world today that will leave Seventh-day Adventists without mercy or justice. While we, Netflix, Facebook, and Instagram are spirituality away, while we are so engaged and engrossed with how we are keeping up with the Kardashians, we can't even understand who Jesus Christ really is. We want to know what Kim and Kanye are doing and what will they name their next child rather than the child Christ Jesus. We're so caught up with the things of this world, we can be no heavenly good or even engage our mind and wrap our mind about this great battle that's being formed up in our day. And even we see the drumbeat and the marshaling the war and the preparation to put a people outside of the parameters of law and justice by what we see today. But guess what? We're fast asleep. Fast asleep. There was a time when Adventists knew this message. They would hear this message all the time. When's the last time you heard the Battle of Armageddon preached in the church? When? This is one of our long coat messages. We could preach this message anywhere and draw a crowd because we could preach the message with power and show them right where we were in the prophetic screen. Look at the word of God, brothers and sisters. We are here and we're fast asleep. But the Bible says that this threefold union, a parallel to the three that were brought down in heaven, this power is going to, in the last days, do a mighty work of bringing a group to a false experience, while the three angels' message is going to bring people to a true experience. And these are the two groups manifest in the last days. Either they're going to be on God's side or the side of the prince of darkness. See that in the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 16 and verse 2. Notice what happens to those that believe in the three frog message and believe this message of the last days of deception. In Revelation 16 and verse 2, it says this. Revelation 16 and verse 2, it says, and the first went out and poured out his vial upon the earth, and there fell a noisome and grievous sore upon the men that had the mark of the beast, and upon them which worshipped his, who only would be partaking in the wrath of God or the seven last plagues. Who only? Those that have the mark of the beast and who worshipped his image. And who are going to worship his image? The 13th chapter of Revelation says, that the false prophet, Revelation 19 makes it clear, the false prophet did miracles before the first beast of Revelation 13 and caused the people to be deceived into worshiping the beast and receiving the mark. So when we look at this, brothers and sisters, this message that we see, even the threefold union, is working to bring a people to receive the mark of the beast in the last days. However, the 15th chapter of Revelation and verse 2 again says this, in Revelation 15 and verse 2, because not everyone will be on the side of iniquity. Not everyone be on the side of the papal Sabbath. In Revelation chapter 15 and verse 2, it says, and I saw as it were a sea of glass mingled with fire, and then had gotten the victory over the beast. Amen. And over his image. Amen. And over his mark. And over the number of his name, stand on the sea of glass, having the harps of God. Brothers and sisters, somebody's going to have victory in Jesus. And it might as well be you and me. It might as well be you and me. We have all the opportunity at this time. We have air-conditioned tents to hear the gospel. Praise God. But what are we doing with our opportunities, brothers and sisters? There are some people in Africa right now and various parts of the world that are under trees in heat, prophesying, studying the prophecies. No air conditioning. But they're happy to be where the Spirit of God is. Great comfort has been afforded you to not be distracted with flies and bugs and heat, so you can, in meditation, without distraction, study and meditate upon the Word of God and make a decision for Him immediately. But what will we do in opportunities? Two groups. One, they get the victory over the beast and his mark and his image. And others that yield to this power because of these two contending forces and being deceived in this battle of Armageddon. This battle at the Valley of Megiddo. The Valley of Megiddo. Now, brothers and sisters, let's make a little more close application. Close application. We look at the large view. Now look at the more close view. These ideas and principles of the Valley of Megiddo or the Battle of Armageddon is based upon Old Testament imagery. In the book 1 Corinthians, it tells us that the spiritual things of the Word of God are not easily understood except God reveals them to us. And they're understood by comparing spiritual things with spiritual things. Now, what are these spiritual things to be compared with spiritual things? Well, the Bible says in John 6 and verse 63, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Comparing scripture with scripture, we're able to understand the Word of God. Because God speaks once, He speaks twice, yea, three times, but men perceive it not. And by three witnesses, any single thing shall be established. We must compare the scriptures together to get a clear understanding. That is how the Bible is own expositor. And according to the book of Isaiah, we can understand even the principles of the refreshing. We can understand what truth is and receive the doctrine. When we look at the Old Testament, we find that there was, in the Old Testament, a battle literally of Megiddo. But the literal and local battles of the Old Testament have a larger spiritual context at the end of time. What you have, what you call literal local, and then future spiritual worldwide. Literal local, spiritual future worldwide. Or it's called type and antitype also. Because when we look at the sanctuary, wasn't Jesus typified in the sanctuary as the Lamb of God? Was Jesus a literal lamb? that literal lamb and those literal lambs pointed forward to a individual with the characteristics of a lamb that would similarly be slain while innocent. It was a simile or a allegory, if you will, an acted prophecy in the scripture. So with all the scriptures, many of these scenes and these events and these names and happenings have a spiritual context that unless we understand the language and the motif of Daniel Revelation, it can escape our mind because spiritual things are, and what are spiritual things? Things by the word comparing scripture with scripture. Faith come by hearing, and hearing by the? And the reason why we have no faith is because we don't read the Bible. We have nothing to have our faith on. It's like coming home and taking off my coat and putting it on the wall and it falls on the ground. I say, what happened? But there's no nail there. The Bible and those scriptures are a nail in a sure place. And when we look at the book of Judges, we're going to see that God has given us the imagery to understand in the Old Testament the situation, the symbols, and the events that surround the last day struggle with greater understanding. Look at the book of Judges now. In the Old Testament, the book of Judges. You have you have the book of Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, and what? Judges. After the book of Judges is Judges. Judges, the fifth chapter. How many are still with me? Amen. If you understand so far, say amen. Amen. If you want to go farther, say amen. 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 Praise God. Judges 5. In Judges 5 and verse 19, brothers and sisters, we can understand the prophecies because the Spirit of God is helping us. Helping us. Judges 5. Judges 5, verse 19. If you are Bible students, I know you're all Bible scholars out there. The fourth chapter of Judges speaks of a battle that's spoken of historically, poetically, and prophetically in the fifth chapter. A scene and a scenario is brought on in the fourth chapter of Judges that is recounted through poetry, history, and prophecy in the fifth chapter through a prophet. In the fourth chapter of Judges, we see that the Word of God says that the small company of Israel, the little company of Israel, God's precious apple of his eye, was surrounded by all the kings of Canaan. And the Canaan land is a type of the whole world. Because again, the promised land was a type of the people of God going to inherit their possession. And our possession is not a place in Palestine, it's the whole world. It's the new earth. Abraham was told, wherever your foot rests, that's where your land, that's your inheritance. And he left Babylon and went into all the world. He was to be a blessing to how many nations? All nations. He was to inherit the whole world. Canaan was a type of the whole world. So if all the kings of Canaan came in and tried to attack little Israel, it's a type of all the world, or a world order trying to destroy the people of God. Can you see it? It's symbolism. It's a symbol in the Old Testament of a future battle that we must be acquainted with that's raging even now. In Judges 5, it says it this way. Look at how the prophet puts the illustration out so we can understand it. Judges 5, Judges the fifth chapter and verse 19. Say amen if you have that. Amen. Judges 5, verse 19. Notice the prophetic language here that gives an understanding of this battle by the river, this battle of Armageddon. And before we read that, hold 1 second. Hold your finger in verse 19. Let's understand also for your notes that when we look at the Word of God, the Word of God shows over and over again battles and the falling of evil cities by the river. God over and over again brings evil cities to destruction by the river. Egypt had a river going through it called the Nile. And that city came to destruction and it fell by the river. Babylon had a river called the Euphrates, and it was destroyed and made way for the Medes and Persians by the river. And this is a type of the end time, because the end time is dealing with spiritual Babylon, but the same scenario is brought to view in the story of this battle of Megiddo by an ancient river. In Judges 5, it says this in verse 19. I hope you're with me. I'm just getting warmed up. You know I can talk fast. Got to take this video and slow it down in a minute. I'm kicking the overdrive. Judges 5, verse 19 says this. It says the kings, notice the prophetic language, the kings came and fought. They fought the kings of Canaan in Taanach. By the waters of Megiddo, they took no gain of money. They fought from, in other words, this battle was not just upon the earth, this battle was fought from. The prophet said, hey, I wish you would open the eyes of my servant to see that there's more with us than with them. The prophet was seeing even the armies of heaven. The prophet was surrounded by human armies, and they came to destroy him. His servant looked down and said, oh, alas, my father, we're about to die. And God open his eyes. Let me see that there's more for us, because we have the armies of heaven fighting on our side. these earthly forces were fighting not against the prophet alone, a little old man. They were fighting from here. These Canaanites thought they would vanquish Israel, but the fight and the battle came from heaven to deliver God's people. And there will be kings of the east. And when we are come to our darkest point, and we're in prison cells and held down, and we're being challenged for our faith, and we seem like the darkest time has come, then heaven will open and the armies will come and rescue us as well. It's a type of the last days. In Judges 5, it says this. Judges 5, they fought, verse 20, they fought from heaven. The stars in their courses fought against Sisera. The river of Kishon swept them away. That ancient river, the river of Kishon. Oh, my soul, thou hast trodden down strength. Even the soul, the experience of the people was able to fight and trod down the strength of mighty armies. Do we have an experience in the last days? Are we developing experience and a character that will draw down the armies of this earth and have the victory in Jesus despite all the technology of the world? All the stealth bombers, all the lasers, all the various piercing bullets, all these things are nothing to the soul of those that are held and kept by God. And unless you understand that, that thousands will fall on their side, but none will come nigh thee, unless those promises are true to you, you can't get through this battle of Armageddon. We must develop the character, the soul strength, to overcome the armies and the powers and the principalities of this world. Are you with me? The kings came and fought against them. The king and the battle came from heaven. In other words, this war by Megiddo was a war of heaven and earth. A war of heaven and earth. A divine and human war. A war of spiritual proportions. Oh, brothers and sisters, are you seeing this truth? Are you seeing this truth? Heaven and earth fought. And Sisera came to his naught. All the kings, the whole world was brought to naught. When we look at the book of Jeremiah now, note the prophets. We don't have time to look at all of it. But the prophets also pick up this imagery and this thought and place it in another context, the context of Babylon. In the book of Jeremiah, we turn to Jeremiah chapter 25. In Jeremiah, we see a concept I often teach in my teachings or in my videos called War on Babylon. Called what?
War on Babylon.
The War on Babylon scenario or motif is vital to understand the prophecy. You can't understand the trumpets without the war in Babylon. Because war in Babylon shows you where we're going and what the idea of these trumpets and the blowing of war is. It also shows you how God is going to bring about and cause victory in this great battle that stretched from great controversy heaven all the way to the close of probation and the last days lake of fire. Are you with me? So when we look at the book of Judges 25, sorry, the book of Jeremiah 25, it says this. Jeremiah, the 25th chapter, Jeremiah 25. Let's see that in the context of Babylon now, the same scene. Again, a great city and a war by a river. Babylon also was to make war upon God's people. But notice what it says when we talk about Jeremiah 25. Jeremiah 25, again, talks about Babylon. Even the kings of the north, you know, isn't the king of Babylon called the king of the north? Weren't they called, the Chaldeans called the kings of the north? Didn't they come from the north country? But the Bible, in Jeremiah's language, Jeremiah calls them the kings of the north, but then in prophetic language, he amplifies and says, and with the whole world. Showing that Babylon is not going to be in the end time just one nation, even though it is centered in a nation or in a power, a geopolitical power, but it's going to be a complete or new world order. Jeremiah chapter 25 says this. Jeremiah 25. I'm preaching so much I can't even find my text. Jeremiah 25. Are we in Jeremiah 25? Jeremiah 25 and verse 26. Jeremiah 25, 26. Let's read. And all the kings of where? Far and near, one with another, and all the kingdoms of the... So we're talking about not just a local power, not just Antichrist power, not just a papal power, but also in connection to have control of all the... Just like in Canaan, a type of the whole world, they all fought against God's people. Here we see Babylon with all the kings of the at variance with the truth. All the kings, verse 26, of the north, far and near, one with another, and all the kingdoms of the world, which are upon the face of the earth, and the kings of Shashak shall drink after them. Drink what? What are they drinking? Notice what it says in verse 15. Jeremiah 25, 15. In Jeremiah 25, 15, it says this. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel unto me, take the cup or the wine cup of his fury at my hand and cause all the nations whom I send to drink it. They shall drink and be moved and be mad, lose their reasoning power because of the sword that I will send among. What does the sword represent?
in this context, it means warfare. So as a result of the wine that Babylon drinks, this wine that they're going to drink of, and all nations to drink, what will be the result? Warfare. And don't we see it? Don't we see it? Don't we see the spirit of war? The sabers rattling in Russia, North Korea? Don't we see the sabers rattling in Iran? Don't we see the preparations and the context for war? Donald Trump said he'll beat El Chapo up. He'll beat him up. Let me not get diverted. I'm not even gonna go there. Holy Spirit, please take control of my mind. In Jesus' name. The Bible says they will all drink. God will allow them to drink of the cup. Doesn't the message that we have say that Babylon is fallen? Is fallen because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of a fornication? Jeremiah, Revelation. At first application, last application. We see the same context, but notice the scriptures. Again, it continues on. We're looking at Jeremiah 25, continuing. Jeremiah 25, and look at verse 30 now. Drop your eyes down to verse 30. You can read the whole chapter when you get home. Verse 30 says this: Therefore prophesy thou against them all these words, and say unto them, The Lord shall roar from on high. The Lord's going to roar from on high. That means heaven. And utter his voice from his holy habitation. When is God's voice going to be given? There's two times God's voice is going to be given. To relieve his people and to give his people victory at the death decree and also at the last trump. Put on your notes. We can't talk about everything. It says, he shall roar from on high, utter his voice from his holy habitation. He shall mightily roar upon his habitation. He shall give a shout as they that tread the grapes against all the inhabitants of the earth. Doesn't Revelation 14 speak of the treading of the grapes of wrath in the last days? As the Son of Man is revealed from heaven. It says this, and a noise, verse 37, also verse 31, and a noise shall come to the ends of the earth. For the Lord hath a controversy with the nations. He will plead with all flesh. He will give them that are wicked to the sword. So here comes God now and his armies with his sword to get into this battle of Armageddon when all these nations are gathered against his people. And Jesus said, as much as you've done unto the least of these, my brethren, you've done unto me. When they stormed that embassy in Benghazi, people were ready to go to war, right? Because to attack an American embassy is declaring war on the United States. As much as they've done unto the least of these, my brethren, even unto the remnant, Jesus said, you've done unto me. And we have to call out for reinforcements, call out for a hot extraction. Some of us know, no one in the military here, they don't know what a hot extraction is. Calling in some ordnance. You need to call in some ordnance to drop some bombs, some cluster busters down on the devil's kingdom, to destroy the kingdom, destroy its ammunition, to make this battle even clearer and greater and more victorious for us, to deliver us. Some of us need a cluster buster in our house to break up some of the foolishness that we're involved in. Arguing with your wife and carrying on. Talk about you a Sabbath keeper. You ain't no Sabbath keeper. Sabbath keeper said you need to give your wife rest. You're giving your wife hell. And women will, yeah. Don't say amen too loud. We need to be sanctified. We're on the verge of eternity. The battle of Armageddon is raging. And God is preparing a people. And he's saying that he is about to roar in his habitation and give victory to some, but everlasting damnation to some. What side are we making choice for? When we look at all the signs showing that this great battle is raging to an end. We see here in the book of Jeremiah chapter 25. Jeremiah 25, it says in verse 32 that when he comes with his sword, verse 32, thus saith the Lord host, behold, evil shall go forth from nation to nation. The whole world will be involved in this. And a great whirlwind shall be raised up from the coast of the earth, and the slain of the Lord, have mercy. The slain of the Lord shall be at that day from one end of the earth, even unto the other end of the earth. They shall not be lamented, neither gathered nor buried. They shall be dung upon the ground. There shall be feces upon the ground, left just out in the open to bake in the sun and for the buzzards to eat them. Why? Because there's no one to bury or cry over them, because all the wicked are slain and all the righteous are taken to go and get reinforcement and get a hot extraction to heaven to get rested up for the last battle of Armageddon. You say, what are you talking about? Brother, the Bible just said he'll come with a shout and roar from his heaven, holy habitation, what do you think he's talking about when he comes and shouts and roars and destroys all the wicked, all those that are not under the sign of Prince Emmanuel? 1 Thessalonians puts it this way. Look what it says. Oh, brothers and sisters, when you know the Adventist message, boy, you know something. 1 Thessalonians, brothers and sisters, if the foundation be destroyed, when it comes to understanding the prophecy, what can the righteous do? But these truths are anchored to our soul. 1 Thessalonians puts it this way in verse 4. First, I know, how will the Lord roar from heaven in this battle of Armageddon and come with his armies and his chariots and his white horses with a name written on his thigh and his vesture dipped in blood? How will he come with the armies of heaven to fight if we don't understand this battle? And when is he coming to roar and speak his voice and shout? The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 16 this. 1 Thessalonians 4, Old Testament, New Testament. Here a little, there a little. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 16 says this. It says, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven, heaven and earth, remember that, from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Amen. And that's why there's no one to lament or bury, or carry anywhere else, because all the wicked are slain upon the earth by the brightness, 2 Thessalonians, the brightness of his coming, and we are going to heaven to spend 1,000 years with Christ, 1,000 years with God, going over those books. You know, have you studied these things out before? You said, 1,000 years, where did you get that from? Okay, let's go to the book of Revelation again. Revelation, the 20th chapter. Oh, brother and sister, you know all these things, don't you? Your pastor preaches this all the time, does he not? Huh? Oh, I'm sorry. If you were watching Save the Serve, you would be saying amen. Amen. Commercial break. We're making decisions, brothers and sisters. There's two groups. And when we don't choose, when we're indecisive with our children at home, God gives us over to the other side. To not make a decision is to make a decision. To be indecisive is to be marshaled and swept under the banner of Prince Emmanuel. Revelation 20 says that there is going to be a separation between the righteous and the wicked, and the separation is symbolically seen as a great angel, just as Michael the archangel is seen in Revelation, coming down with a chain, even a chain of circumstances, by which the devil is bound for 1,000 years. And a resurrection takes place, as we saw in 1 Thessalonians, that brings the people out, because all these are points and parcel of this battle of Armageddon, of this spiritual battle by a spiritual river called Babylon, which is the same typology or the same image of this Megiddo, or this ancient city that was anciently seen in Judges and other passages of Scripture. In the book of Revelation 20, we see this. Revelation 20. Oh, please, Heavenly Father, please pour out your Spirit. Let us understand these things and see their import upon us, because we must be making a decision tonight to make a decision for eternity. Oh, Lord, please pour out your Spirit upon me. It's me, oh, Lord, standing in need of prayer. Not only must I hear this message and make an examination of my heart, but I must be prayerful that my words do not cause anyone to not see the tremendous enormity and seriousness of this message and the need of making a decision tonight to make their calling and election sure. You said all that upon the Lord's side, come over here. Lord, we must make a decision tonight. Please pour out your Spirit and anoint my humble mind and heart to speak thy word with clarity, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In the 20th chapter of Revelation again, Revelation 20, it says this. Revelation 20. In Revelation 20 and verse 6, the same thing we saw with the resurrection of the dead. Those that were in the grave being brought up, and those that are alive and remain going to heaven. The Bible here speaks of the resurrection of the righteous that are taken with Jesus to be with him, and gives us even a time that they'll be with him. In Revelation 20, it says this. Revelation 20 and verse 6. In Revelation 26, it says, blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection. Because there's more than one. Blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection. On such, the second death hath no power. Brothers and sisters, it says there's two main criteria brought out here of those taking part in the first resurrection. They are, what does it say? They are blessed and holy. This is a resurrection of the righteous that we see here. And it says the second death, which we see in the book of Revelation chapter 20 and verse 14 and 15, as the lake of fire, it has no power over them. Because it says, verse 6, They shall be priests of God and of Christ and shall reign with him. How long? We're being taken to heaven with Christ to be with him for 1,000 years there before we come back to the earth to claim this earth as our Canaan land, our heavenly, or even I say spiritual inheritance. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 20, this scenario takes place and these people are brought into a situation where they are taken with the Lord for 1,000 years. But how did this happen? In 1 Thessalonians 4, it says, the Lord ascended with a shout and through his instrumentality, he was able to take them, 2 Thessalonians says, and destroy the wicked, just as Jeremiah said. But it puts it this way in Revelation 20, verses 1 and on. Look at Revelation 20 and verse 1. In Revelation 20 and verse 1, again, we're still talking about this battle and these scenes from these battles all over time. In Revelation 20 and verse 1, it says this. Revelation 20 and verse 1. And I saw an angel come down from heaven, just like 1 Thessalonians 4. Having a key of the bottomless pit and a great chain, even of circumstances, in his hand. Now, by the way, write in your notes Lamentations chapter 3 and verse 7 to see what that chain really is. Lamentations 3 and verse 7. It says, he had a great chain in his hand, and he laid hold of the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him a... So the period of time where the saints are in heaven, and all the earth is desolated, and it becomes an abyss, filled with the littered bodies of all his havoc, the devil is bound here 1,000 years. In what way is he bound? The circumstances of the second coming, the circumstances of the second coming upon the earth, upon the wicked, and upon the righteous, bring us a chain of circumstances in which the devil is bound in a situation where he cannot do what he naturally by his nature does. What does it mean? It says this, and cast him, verse 3, into the bottomless pit and shut him up, bound him, and set a seal upon him that here's what happened. Here's this binding that he should not deceive the... We've seen over and over again that all the nations will fight against God, all the nations will fight against his people, and all the nation, all the people of the earth shall be destroyed except those that are taken with Jesus. And they are all upon the earth, so can he deceive the dead? Ecclesiastes 9:5 says the living know that they should die, but the dead know not anything. There's no device, no knowledge, no any type of power in the grave. And there's nothing done in the sun that you know about in the grave. Your sons come to honor and you know it not. If there's any device or any power, you should do it while you're alive, because there's no such power in the grave where you go. Why would God come from heaven to the earth with a shout to get people already in heaven? They're in the grave sleeping until Jesus comes to get them. Even Jesus in the book of John 11 says that Lazarus sleepeth. Death is asleep. And, you know, some people are so confused. You go to a funeral, and the pastor says, she's down there sleeping. She looks so peaceful. She's up in heaven. She's looking down on us right now. Don't she look so peaceful down there? She's resting till Jesus comes. Oh, she's looking down on us right now. And you, people in the congregation going like this, they wonder what is going on. It's confusion. It's Babylon. The truth shall set you free, or make you free, I should say. The truth is powerful. It gives you liberation, and it keeps you from those demons of spiritualism coming to you, as the elder said, and bringing deception, transforming themselves into angels of light, or even the ministers of Christ, or even your grandmama. Saying, oh, don't worry about it, baby. I'm in heaven smoking this pipe or this joint. Oh, I got a whole bunch of women up in heaven. It's a good place. You say, you up there in heaven doing that? Oh, sure. Demons. Demons. I don't have time to tell you stories about instances I've seen of people with these situations. In the book of Revelation 20, we see that Satan is bound for how long? The same time the saints are in heaven. The people upon the earth, or all the nations that fought against God in this battle, are come to naught. They are destroyed. And they lay upon the earth for only 1,000 years. They are dead. They are laying there 1,000 years. Why? Because there's a first resurrection for the righteous, but notice there's a second resurrection after 1,000 years of those nations of the world. Look what it says in the book of Revelation again. We're in Revelation 20. Revelation 20 and verse 7. How long is Satan in the earth? Bound? 1,000 years. And he can't do anything because he's bound, because he cannot deceive the nation because they are dead. They have no knowledge. They're unconscious. They are asleep in the grave, or on the earth, I should say. But after 1,000 years, he is loose or he's unbound because something happened that caused him to have the power now to take back up his work of assault and reignite the Battle of Armageddon. after World War I, when Germany lost and was decimated, their economy was, Brother Sutton can tell you more better than I can, their economy was in the trash, but they laid plans quickly to assemble financial, political, and military strength secretly and overtly to create implements and structures of war to mount another great struggle to take over the whole world. And they came so close, brothers and sisters, so close that even today, documentaries to this day talk about how close it came to having America speak German. Even to the day when you go to Washington, D.C., there are, going down the main strip there in Washington, D.C. toward the White House, there are cherry blossoms going all the way down that are beautiful in the spring. You know where we got those from? Japan sent them to us as a side humorous rebuke and joke because they believed that they wanted to prepare Washington, D.C. for their capital. So they sent the Japanese cherry blossom, which we put all down the main boulevard, thinking that Japan is doing such a good thing for us, but they wanted to march down those streets in victory and have the symbol of the cherry blossom, the chrysanthemum throne. The throne of the emperor is called the chrysanthemum throne, and it's connected with the cherry blossom. So the emperor could walk down with his symbol all the way down as he marched into the White House. We came close to losing this nation. The Bible says, after 1,000 years, this situation called the second resurrection will happen, and those that were against God, all his armies, from the Antediluvians that cursed God in the first age, all the way down to the people in 2015, 16, or wherever God comes, we're waiting for him even now, wherever it stops, the Holy Spirit says that these people, down to our time, will all come up, all of Satan's hosts, are sleeping. All of his armies are in the grave, and he brings them up at once to resume and to create another great assault against the kingdom of God. It says it this way, Revelation 20. We're talking about the battle of Armageddon. Revelation 20 says this, verse 7, and when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison and shall go out to deceive the nations. Notice the language, out to deceive the nations, the whole world, which are in the four quarters of the earth, the whole world. What's the name he puts there? Gog and Magog, to gather them together to the same language of Revelation 16. The 16th chapter of Revelation says to gather them together to that battle of God Almighty. This says to gather them together to the battle. Who? All the world, all the nations. It says the number of whom is at the sand of the sea. Take that in, brothers and sisters, for a moment. It's not just talking about St. Petersburg, Fort Lauderdale, Miami. And even if you count the grains of sand upon the sea, it is almost innumerable just in Florida. The Bible speaks about the land or the sea or the idea of sand on every shore of every continent upon the world is an example of how many wicked have lived upon the earth that will come up at one time to marshal themselves against God. The Bible says, as John looked at it, he said, it looked like the sand of the sea. Innumerable, the wicked that come up. At the second resurrection, we're told about great controversy, they come up just as they went down, crippled and maimed, looking just like this big show that everyone's talking about. They have all these commercials, scaring you to death, the walking dead. Satan is creating these things so that you feel right at home when you wake up the second resurrection and you see people coming up and walking around. You say, oh, it's the apocalypse! And then as your heart is scared because you've been prepared by these movies for the coming time, Satan's preparing you to be in his host. So you won't be too scared. You probably try and get a samurai sword, try and get a gun, and then Satan comes and heals the whole multitude. Wipes the AIDS away, cancer, bullet holes. They will be all redeemed. You don't believe that, do you? Do you believe it? I want to show you that the Word of God said this is going to happen. This is going to be an element of the Battle of Armageddon. But before we do that, we must understand, when we talk about these idea of Gog and Magog, Gog and Magog is not dealing with Russia. It's dealing with all the world, all the nations, all the heathen. Quickly, Ezekiel. We're almost done. We need to close this out. Ezekiel. Gog and Magog is talking about all the heathen, all the nations of every time. Antediluvians before the flood, those in the time of Noah, all the way down to our day, all the wicked will be there. Genghis Khan will be there. He'll be there, and he'll be in a special session teaching Kung Fu and Tai Chi. And you have over here Hitler. He'll be teaching military strategy. Then you have Lao Tzu over here, and you have Sun Tzu, and he'll be teaching military strategy and tactics. Then you have Napoleon. Then you have Caligula. You have Mussolini. You have all these leaders, Pol Pot, that were cheap and vice and evil. They will all play their role, more than likely under antediluvian generals that understood how to splice the DNA and to make things, even with metals and water, that we can never understand. The Spirit of Prophecy says that in that flood of the antediluvians, art and science was lost that we have never even conceived. Never even conceived. Could you imagine having a waterfall in your house and having a flat screen television type picture through water? And be able to, who knows what was done when those men were giants in intellect, size, and depth of wickedness. At the sand, the sea will be all these generations contemporaneously. The contemporaneous collection of wickedness of the ages will be gathered against the saints of God. Revelation says that. Ezekiel says this. Look what Ezekiel says. Who is Gog and Magog? It's all the wicked of all ages. Look at the book of Ezekiel quickly. Ezekiel. Ezekiel, the 38th chapter. Quickly. Ezekiel 38. Come with me. Ezekiel 38. Ezekiel 38. Write in your notes. Ezekiel 38, verse 2. 14 through 16. Ezekiel 38, verses 2, then verse 14 through 16. Quickly, let's go. Please, hurry. Time is running out. Spirit is moving. Ezekiel 38, verse 2 says this. Son of man, set thy face against Gog and against the land of Magog, the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal, and prophesy against him. Prophesy against him. Interesting. It says this in verse 14. You didn't get that. Verse 14. Therefore, did you get it? You got it. Amen. Therefore, son of man, prophesy and say unto Gog, thus saith the Lord God, in that day when my people Israel dwell safely, shalt thou not know it? And thou shalt come from thy place out of the what? The north parts, the king of the north, the part of the north, and with many people with thee, all of them riding upon horses and a great company and a mighty army. And thou shalt come up and against my people of Israel as a cloud to cover the land. It shall be in the latter days. There it is. It shall be in the latter days. And I will bring thee against my land that all the heathen, that the heathen may know me when I shall be sanctified in thee, O Gog, before their eyes. Who is Gog? All the heathen. All the heathen will know God when he destroys God, because they're all going to be there. Gog and all the nations are going to be gathered against God's people. When? In the latter days. Write in your notes, Ezekiel 39, verse 17 through 22, where again it says the same thing, that Gog and Magog are all the heathen. All the heathen. And they'll be laid upon the earth for the fowls of heaven to eat, just like Revelation 19 says, the great supper of the Lord. Brothers and sisters, we're closing. Look at Joel, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos. Okay, are we there? Joel, the third chapter. Brothers and sisters, we've seen many battles down through time, explained them, looked at them, and examined this idea of the Battle of Armageddon that's raging and will be recurring to a crescendo at the resurrection of the dead, at the close of probation. And when the close of probation takes place and this resurrection takes place, we see that God is going to cause a ceasefire, as it were, for how long? 1,000 years. Then a collection of evil over the whole age of humanity will raise at one time and be gathered together to fight against God. They'll be brought out of the grave as the saints are in heaven, finishing up their work of judgment. They are waiting and watching and enjoying the joys of heaven, while down the earth there is marshaling to war. The Battle of Armageddon has resumed its power, and it will come to this last and final struggle. And I wonder where I will be. I wonder where you will be. I want to be in the city. I want to be where the streets are made of gold. I want to be where those walls are transparent. I want to be where the sun doesn't need to shine. I want to be where the sanctuary is filled with the people that have gone and have red borders around their garments because they've gone through great tribulation. I want to see, as Ellen White said, the little children run and then with their wings just fly. I want to see it. I want to be there. I want to see the thousands, maybe millions of children, maybe who knows how they died, laying at Jesus' feet. Some people that have never had children in their life will have to take 2 and 3, maybe 1,000 to take care of them. They're taking bottles just for 1,000 years, just changing bottles and diapers. There'll be children in heaven. It's a wonderful thing to think of. But unless we make a decision tonight, let's make a decision. Right now is the hour to make a decision, brother and sister. We're making a decision for the battle of Armageddon right now. Right now. We're on the front lines, brothers and sisters. You know why we're on the front lines? Because as Penitent Space says, the enemy says, that little company I hate. They're the chief object of my fury. If I could just blot them out of existence, my triumph would be complete. We're on the front lines. You've enlisted in the special forces. And there's a price on your head. And the weapons of your warfare cannot be carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. We must cast down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. When you come into the master's service, he gives you these weapons so that you can fight manfully and skillfully as a good soldier. The Bible says, he teaches my fingers to fight. A spiritual warfare. Now, of course, someone's going to take this and go outside and start fighting people in the parking lot. I know. Brother Cofer said, he told me, my finger to fight. And the police will come and take you away, and we'll say, Maranatha. Spiritual things. Spiritual things. These individuals that are taken to the city are blessed and holy. Do you know what it really means to be blessed and holy? Joel says the wicked will be coming up out of the grave, and the Bible says that they're going to be not only asleep, but the Bible says here, they'll be awakened to come to battle. Just as the Bible said, they'll be awakened from the grave. You don't believe me? Look at Joel. Let the Bible teach you. In the book of Joel, chapter 3. Joel 3 and verse 2. Notice that everything we've seen in Ezekiel and Jeremiah and all the prophets of the old is seen again in Joel for the last days that we see coming to our day, even now, as the miracle-working power of Satan is amplifying throughout the earth with spiritualism, both innocuous and overt. Harry Potter on one side, and Detroit with a statue of Satan in public. Oh, brothers and sisters, we are here. You can worship Baphomet in public. You're not over there drinking blood in some little secret. In public, you have an image of Satan in a public square. Mercy. And we're talking about gay rights. Have mercy. Joel 3 says this. Joel 3, as we close. Joel 3 and verse 2. I will also gather all nations and will bring them down into the valley of Jehoshaphat and will plead with them there for my people and for my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations and parted my land. And they have cast lots for my people and have gotten or given a boy for a harlot and sold a girl for wine, and that they may drink. Look at verse 9. It says, proclaim ye among the Gentiles. That means the heathen. Prepare war. Wake up the mighty men. Are they sleeping? They're in the grave. This is a last day struggle, and the majority, all of the hosts of Satan at this last scene are going to be where? In the grave. Awakened by the second resurrection to come to the battle of Armageddon, the last struggle in the great controversy. Joel 3 and verse 9 says, proclaim ye this among the Gentiles. Prepare war. Wake up the mighty men. Let all the men of war draw near. Let them, what? Out of the grave. Beat your plowshares into swords. That means that they're going to take all the things upon the earth and refashion these things of the earth, even things that are left by the righteous for agriculture, and make everything available, every scrap, into weapons of war. When that great city comes down, you talk about lasers, airplanes. They're able to come up on the side of the city because they have technology and weaponry to do it. They want to take by force what the Lamb has been trying to give them all along. Well, the Lamb came and gave his dying breath and blood to give. Now they want to try and grab it from him in one last struggle and battle against God. It says, beat your plow, verse 10. Beat your plowshares into swords. Go ahead. And your pruning hooks into spears. Let the weak say, what? Those coming out of the grave with AIDS, coming up just as they went down with cancer, riddled with bullets from a drive-by, stabbed to death, they shot themselves in the head, they gave poison and killed themselves. They were in the midst of all type of iniquity and abomination. And as they went down, they came up. But the Bible said not only would God allow them to take implements of the earth and make them into weapons, but the weak from sin and degradation coming to the second resurrection will suddenly say, I am, because they'll be manifestly healed by the power of Satan. Great controversy says it clearly in the last chapter. Satan will come and will exercise his power upon them, and he will heal every living person upon the earth with his own, she says, electrical current. Ellen White says that all the fallen angels are energized by him. They have this long time existed without the benefit of heavenly manna and the food of angels and the benefit of heavenly environment, because they've been energized from the inherent power in Satan. He is in himself powerful. Ellen White says that beside the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, he is the most intelligent and powerful being in the universe. And not only has he been keeping and sustaining all these hosts of angels for thousands of years, but when all the sand of the sea multiplied billions of wicked come up out of the graves, he will, with his own inherent power, heal all of them and feel no lack. Heal every disease that's been plaguing this earth for thousands of years and feel no lack. If Satan was given his reign to do everything he could heal every disease with just the power of regeneration. It's not creation, the power of regeneration that's in him. And now this deception is allowed because it's already too late. They've already made this, their mind is already completely beyond redemption. They are corrupt. They are seared. This miracle cannot affect them one way or the other. The weak shall say what? I am now, I come out of the grave, strong. Assemble yourselves, verse 11, and come all ye heathen and gather yourselves together round about thither, cause thy mighty ones to come down, O Lord. Here from heaven now, the earth is this. Now the heavens, the mighty ones come down. Who are the mighty ones? Those in the city, the angels, the Father, the Son, and the power of the Holy Spirit around them. Let thy mighty ones come down, O Lord. Let the heathen be wakened out of the grave and come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat, for there will I sit to judge all the heathen round about. Put in the sickle, for the harvest is ripe. Come, get ye down, for the press is full. The vats overflow, for their wickedness is great. Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision, for the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. Tonight, brothers and sisters, tonight you have to make a decision. This valley of decision begins tonight. Yes, in the last days, there'll be a time where there's no more decision, but this valley of decision is not for the people. At that time, where the probation is closed and their mind is seared, multitudes in the valley of decision tonight, what will you choose when the mighty ones come down? And according to Revelation chapter 20, that great city comes down out of heaven. That great city adorned like a bride for her husband comes down, and the wicked see this city, and they are not able to control their wrath. What it says in the book of, hold your finger there and look at the book of Revelation 20. And Revelation 20 puts it this way. They're not able to contain their wrath. That which they could have had through grace, they want to take by force. And the 20th chapter of Revelation says this. Revelation 20 and verse 7, it says this. In Revelation 20, verse 7, I gotta go, hope you got it. And when the thousand years are expired, Satan be loosed out of his prison and shall go out to deceive the nations that are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is at the sand of the sea. And they went up on the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about the beloved city. And fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. The battle of Armageddon is now complete. Now the fire of the lake of fire now is going to completely purify the earth and finish the great controversy. But brothers and sisters, let's not let us escape the thought of what happens too quickly. Because when this great city comes out, the book of Revelation says that the walls of this great city that house these powerful, mighty ones, mighty in righteousness, mighty in holiness and humbleness, those that have been redeemed from the earth, those that have been redeemed by Jesus, as these walls about them that protect them, the Bible says they're transparent gold, which means that they are going to, with impossibly powerful eyes, not 20/20, but more like 2 billion vision, see telescopic and microscopic, from out in space to the most minute atom in the sunbeam. These eyes are going to be able to see through that wall, and they're going to look out, and mother is going to see son, and wife is going to see husband, and churchmen will see their pastor out with weapons of war, coming to kill every person in the city. Those that have preached the three in his message will be outside the city. Conference presidents, present truth believers, people that have even had home church will be outside the city. And they'll be sitting there with those weapons of war, and they'll come up and they'll get ready to fire, and they'll see their mother, and they'll drop their weapon. And the mother will look out. The Bible says he'll wipe away every tear after. The mother look out and she's seen every sin he committed because she looked over the books. She had looked already. She'll know why Jesus couldn't allow him in, and here he's giving manifest evidence of it. And she'll look out. But because she still has a mother's heart, a tear will fall from her eye. That's her flesh. My son. She'll say like David, my son, my son, my son. Oh, how can I let you go? How can I let you go? And people will look out and they'll see their first grade teacher. That first grade teacher, that kindergarten teacher. You know that one? The one that was so kind to you and took you up and just hugged you. And when you spilled your milk and you didn't have all your chocolate milk spilled and you started crying, she picked you up and she gave you another chocolate milk. Now, chocolate vegan milk for those of now. And you looked up and he says, thank you, Miss Ratner. Drank that chocolate milk and almost got a fever because it was so poisoned and polluted, but nevertheless, you love that chocolate milk. You see her in the city and you don't know why, after she gave you so much love and attention in that church school, that you went in that way of unrighteousness and you went all the way to a crisis grave. But here you are fighting against God and his people. Pastors will see church members that they stayed up nights praying for. Pastors' wives will see husbands that preach the gospel outside the city. Pastors that beat their wives, abuse them, are going to see this wife no longer beaten and bloodied anymore. No more abused and called stupid and fool and fat. And all. No, she's in the city where eternal beauty. She's beautiful now. And all she has is a look of love and pity through those transparent gates. Eyes will meet. Children will see their progeny for 1,000 years. Could you imagine Abin seeding his children for 1,000 and 6,000 years? All the people of the earth, Adam will recognize them as his own. And I see Adam in my mind's eye, my preaching eye, weeping, 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 weeping. My sin, my sin. Oh, the thought of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Adam will say, oh, my soul, as all his children are outside the city. Oh, brothers and sisters, multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision. The Bible says the day of the Lord, let's look back at it, the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. Let's read it, Joel 3, multitudes, verse 14. Joel 3:14, the multitudes. Multitudes, there it is. Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision. For the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. Brothers and sisters, if God has moved upon your heart tonight, God has moved upon your heart to think about the eternal laws. The book Desire Ready says that as the dusty graves are opening, the people are coming out saying, free, free, eternal life. She said that when they come out of this grave, they will scream, eternal life. As they come out, and they'll be bursting from the grave, and mothers will be coming up to meet Christ in the air. As they're coming up, angels will come up to them and bring children lost in death and place those children in their arms, swaddled and clean. And mothers with tears will come to heaven seeing this child they lost in infancy, lost in premature labor, lost in various ways, even children, maybe even they were aborted. God may redeem those children. You don't know. What would God do when you give him his heart, your heart? But she said also, oh, how many I saw with no mother. The mother did not live a life of Christ. And those babies are taken to heaven to be placed at the foot of Jesus. But there was no mother found for them. They're put at Jesus' feet to be cared for. Oh, brothers and sisters. Oh, brothers and sisters. Multitudes. What decisions are you making for your home? For your heart? The battle of Armageddon is raging in your home. Your cable. Your television. Your radio, your refrigerator, your relationships, your Facebook, your Instagram, are these things sanctified? Or are they a part of the Battle of Armageddon? Has the enemy stolen a mark and does he have spies and infiltrators in your house? Are you an agent of righteousness or unrighteousness? Whose eyes will you meet through those transparent walls? You may see a mother or brother, brothers and sisters, can you imagine your eyes coming with all that hatred to try and fight as you've been training, as you come and put that gun, you meet the eyes of Jesus. Loving and compassionate, still full of love and mercy. And you become transfixed at the inexpressible love of that singular person among all that are similar to him. And you wonder, wasn't heaven cheap enough? Tonight, heaven is cheap enough. Tonight, there's still opportunity. Tonight, still, there's time. Before many in this room go to a Christless grave, tonight we can make a decision to choose Jesus. He says, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Even the rest of the blessed and holy that you may come up in the first resurrection, I will give you life and life more abundantly. If any man confesses sin, he said, I am faithful and just to forgive him his sin and to cleanse him from all unrighteousness. We need that cleansing tonight. Oh, brothers and sisters, if you have been touched by the power of God tonight, God has spoken to your heart in some way, and you've seen yourself come up to the precipice of destruction, and you need redeeming power tonight, won't you come? Won't you come? Won't you come? Come unto me, Jesus says. Calm down. Right now, as we prepare to close this meeting, if God's moved upon your heart, wherever you may be, if you're young, if you're old, we're having a baptism tomorrow. And some of you may need Bible studies. Praise God. Some of you may need a little bit more study and merit. Praise God. Some of you are seeing yourself and not, brothers and sisters, if God's moved upon your heart, then you need redeeming grace. I want you to come down. If you came down last night, come down. If you feel the power of God moving, come down. Come on, come on, come on. One, two, amen, amen. See, you're free. You're free. You're free. Heavenly Father, I pray that you would remove Satan from this building even now. And all his holy angels that come in to try and distract and disturb, move them out by the power of your holy angel and free those that want to make a decision tonight. Come on down. Come on down. You're free. We pray. In the name of Jesus, you're free. Come down. Come on. One, two, three. Come on. Come on. Amen. 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 Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble. Hear my humble. While on others, on others thou art called. Do not pass me by. As you hear the words of this song, you can slip out of your seat and come on down. Jesus calling you. Come on down. Come on. Savior. Let's sing it out. Hear my humble cry. Oh, do not pass me by. I want you to hum that. Hum that. Just hum that very quickly. The quietly. There are some in their seats right now that if they looked in the future, they would see themselves on the wrong side of those transparent walls. And in horror, they would recoil and try and run up here. But it'd be too late. Because it may be God at the last day showing you this scene where opportunity was given you. Some may leave here tonight and drive on I-4 or 429 and meet with an untimely death. Pastor Tim and I were in a meeting one time, and there was a young boy. We're getting ready for baptism. And we had a few days before the last day when we were coming to the Sabbath. He made a decision on Wednesday night, and we were looking to Sabbath for the baptism. He went the very next day after making a decision, and then wondering, keep going, come on, please, keep going. Savior, you're my singing evangelist. We're working for others. You've come, but we have others to work for. He went to the dentist to get his teeth fixed, his teeth cleaned, to get some minor work. And the dentist put him under anesthesia, and he coded and died. He was a teenager. We were riding the bus in Chicago. Pastor Tim used to go and pick up contacts. And we were riding with Pastor Tinsley. And there was a young boy out in front of a project. We went to go pick up some young people. And the young boy was riding a little bike. And one of the girls said, hey, come on. I think his name may be Johnny. I can't remember what his name was. He said, come on, Johnny. Come on, you can go to church. Jesus loves you too. A little girl, Jesus loves you too. Come on, we're all going to the tent. Come on, we're going to crusade. It's good. You got to love Jesus too. And he seemed kind of embarrassed because his friend maybe looking around. He said, I don't know. No, I'll come later. I don't have any clothes. I believe Timothy said, don't worry, Matt. You can go and wash them right now. And it'll be dry by the time I come back. I'll go and pick up some people. I'll come right back for you. He said, I don't know. And Timothy talked with him. The girl talked with him. And Timothy convinced him to go home and change. Timothy came back. Nowhere to be found. Timothy waited. Timothy was late to the meeting that night, waiting for him, didn't see him. Came that night, had a powerful meeting, dropped the people off. When he came the next night to pick them up, the girl came to the van and said, you know what? They found little Johnny shot in the alley last night. Apparently, he left when Pastor Tinsley left and went around in the alley and they shot and killed him. He could have got on the van. Tinsley said, leave your bike right there and you come on right now. Tinsley was the last voice of mercy. He was going to take him to a place of safety, a city of refuge. He said, no, a little bit later. A bullet ripped through his cranium and killed him that night, a teenager. Now, some of you are older. Some of you have been living lives, and you know, I don't just spell out, the Holy Spirit spells out your need. So you sing the stanza one more time. I'm praying that the Holy Spirit move on your heart and you would make a decision. Because you know what? I don't know your life. These people don't know your life. But some of your wives know if you're really living the life or not. Some of your husbands, some of your children know. And what example are you setting before them when they know how you're living and they see you sitting like all is well in Jerusalem? Lead out. You take a stand for God, your children may change. Your children may be saved. Your wife, husband, lead your homes. Parents, lead your children. Let God move upon your heart tonight and make a decision. One more time, I'm going to sing Path, Knowledge, and the Savior. And while we sing this song, it's your opportunity to come down and take the hand of Jesus. One, two, three. Pass me not, O gentle. Oh, sweetly singing, sweetly singing. My soul needs it. My humble cry. While on others, while on wherever you are, step out of your seat. Come on, we're gonna have prayer. There's still time. There's still room. There's still time. There's still room. There's still time. There's still room for you. To the north, to the south, to the east, and to the west. God's salvation is shining tonight. There's still room. Oh, why will you die, O house of Israel? Come and buy without money or without price. As the pastor sings, praise. You can sing if you want to. We're praying that the Holy Spirit will move upon hearts and the decision we made for Jesus tonight. Tonight, we can take our side for eternity.